Hello, America, across the fruited plain. This is on. Hello, David.
Hi, Gary.
Oh, wait, do I have music to
play? You got to start with the intro. We got to have music. And
we start music with music and stuff there. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Ham Radio Now, the most important. It's not going.
No.
I can push the button.
It won't play. It's loaded. The bug won't. Oh, I'm pushing the wrong button.
There it is.
That's the problem. The most important, but also the most inept ham radio program on the internet. And on the other side of the screen from me is...
Live from the garage below my parents' house along Mulholland Drive at the base of the Santa Monica Mountains at Topanga Canyon, I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And from the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, in the shadow of Charlotte, and the foot of Mount Belzoni, I am Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, and
We have a guest.
We have a guest. Oh, wait, I forgot.
And there's lower third for the guest.
I forgot to put up the name of the show. I got it here somewhere. I'm pushing all the wrong buttons.
Ta-da!
Legal Ham Radio.
No.
That is really just clickbait.
That's okay. And don't worry, we do never follow the title unless we really have to.
Yeah, once in a while we mention the name of the title. And actually, Jonathan, I've got a little title thing for you here. And I didn't get a chance to ask you if it was okay. How does that look?
It looks perfect.
It's got, you're right. Got your website,
which is
down there.
Way better than most of the time that Jonathan ends up on our net script where I dyslexia the L and the K.
He's and I don't follow the script very well.
Yeah, exactly. So it all works perfect. Welcome, Jonathan.
I'm delighted to be here.
Well, we're delighted to have you, and thanks for putting up with the awesome start that we had. Not on time, and everything went according to the plan that we never have.
Jonathan, you are a lawyer.
I am a lawyer.
And you just started.
I didn't start out that way.
And you just started the meter on us.
Yeah.
No, this one, I'll find an account to write it off to. Don't worry.
Yay.
Notice he didn't say he's doing it for free. He said to find a place to stuff it.
Out of the love of the hobby and ham radio, right, Jonathan?
You know, as an amateur radio operator for over 50 years, yes, I have a love for this hobby.
Okay, which one have you hammed first?
Only 50 years?
53 years now. 53 okay. Years since I got my novice license in high school, and it makes me feel old.
All right. I'll make you feel younger. 59 years since I got my license, my novice there license in high school.
Yeah. I think I'm going on...
You got QCWA now, David. Don't worry.
I think I'm getting on 13 now.
Oh, you don't have 25?
Oh, you're a baby.
Yeah, I'm nowhere near that. I think 2011 is my date. So, yeah, maybe 13 years now. It's all good. So you said you didn't start off as an attorney, but you're an amateur radio operator before then.
So my backstory is that before I even graduated elementary school, I was building crystal radios. In fact, I built a crystal radio and gave a lecture on the history of radio broadcasting from the transmission side for my sixth grade class at Clover Elementary School here in Los Angeles. And made no sense why I was into radio that early, but I was. My father was a rabbi. My grandfather on one side sold shoes. The other side, he was a finance guy. So I had no background in communications, but that's genetically how apparently I got wired. Mm-hmm. And from elementary school to junior high. In junior high, I was introduced to CB radio at Palms Junior High School, now Palms Middle School, because, you know, we have to change names.
Yep.
And played in that hobby for a little while. My father got us a family license, KDK1107. I remember that was the call sign, our CB call sign. And then when I went off to Hamilton High School here in Los Angeles, I was finally exposed to amateur radio through K6CXI, the club station at Hamilton. And Jack Brown, the incredibly important person in so many of our lives in high school, the head of the electronics program, fostered a tremendous number of ham radio operators, myself included. I got my license, my novice license, in high school, and now I've progressed all the way up to amateur extra, and then picked up a few other FCC licenses along the way. But really, my foundation in amateur radio came from high school and operating the AM repeater at the time. I'm trying to remember, it was a Bob Gonsitz AM repeater on top of Mount Wilson that used to go bong.
I remember the name Art Gentry, I believe.
Art Gentry, that was it. That was it.
Yeah, I only know that
was the radio.
I only know that from Bill Pasternak.
And I ran across Bill Pasternak in my days here because he and I were in the same radio clubs together. I think I recall. Well, in any event, not that important. But no, I my amateur radio career starts back then, and my father wisely saw my interest in amateur radio and thought that he would support me. So he bought me at that time a lifetime membership in the ARRL. And this is back in the 70s when that membership cost an ungodly 180 some odd dollars for a lifetime membership. I think I've gotten my value out of that membership. I think my father's investment was well-placed.
David, I sound like we're interviewing me. Because almost everything is identical except for the AM repeater in L.A. Because I was in Chicago and we had FM repeaters back then.
Nice. And going off to high school and becoming a ham radio operator, opened incredible doors for me. Not the least of which was my ability to go to college, because my grades in high school were not that great.
Was it like an electronics class in high school, or did they have just a club, or how did that work?
Electronics class and a club.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they had an electronics program, and a lot of interesting people came through that program, some of who would go on to do really interesting things, and some of them would be infamous in their own way. We had some phone hackers. We had... the person who gave me my amateur radio license, Mark Abrams, the BA6DPB, went on to found Raycom, which was, it still is today, a major LA market, LA market communication service station, and he owns a number of radio hilltops. And in fact, a case that he was part of ended up going up to the Supreme Court on amateur radio and commercial radio from his home. So I was lucky to meet a lot of interesting people coming through high school and going through amateur radio. But it opened the door to college for me, because my grades weren't that great in high school, but I was admitted to Cal State Northridge because the person who was reviewing my application during an in-person interview said, you know, you have a ham radio license, you did a federal test, you know, you probably do college work. And it was because of my amateur radio license that I was admitted to Cal State Northridge. I didn't stay there long. I stayed at Cal State Northridge for a couple of years and really didn't like it. I wasn't using my hands. I was certainly going through the programs, and I remember learning about SAMOS, early computer language, but I wasn't doing what I wanted to do. So as has been the case many times in my life, I took the road less traveled, and I went from a four-year university to a two-year junior college, Los Angeles Trade Technical College here in LA, which had a really incredible RF communications program. So incredible, in fact, that Motorola and other major corporations were advisors and sponsors of that program. And in fact, I came out through that program at the top of the class, and I was hired even before I graduated by Motorola to work in really what were their advanced projects at the time, the RAF program management group. And they were the group that did the new stuff, the stuff that hadn't actually been built. Motorola had, at least at that point, a wonderful process of the salespeople going out and selling these incredible communication systems to public agencies and sheriffs and fire departments and so forth that actually hadn't been put together yet. And I was on a team that did that, in fact, for the first simulcast system in Kern County. That's where I was hired out of LA Trade Tech even before I graduated to go work on that. The fun story about that is I actually had to leave to go up to Bakersfield where the project was based before the classes ended. And it may have been that the instructors at LA Trade Tech kept my attendance going so that I actually appeared to be in class every day, even though I was up working for Motorola already and I graduated. But by that time I was already working for Motorola. So I can trace that all the way back to amateur radio. I'm a firm believer in the foundation of amateur radio for many careers, as I myself have experienced, but I see so many people in amateur radio who started and have gone off and done interesting things, but stayed connected to the hobby because of the technology and because of the camaraderie. It's a neat place to be an amateur radio operator. So that's a little bit of my backstory, getting into the business.
So it's an interesting path. So you started a 4-year school and then you went back to, and now you're a lawyer. That happened along the way.
Yeah, I didn't hear the lawyer part.
Yeah.
So the lawyer part's an interesting one. So I graduated in 1977 from LA Trade Tech, something like that, with my Associate of Science in Radio Communications. And that was the only degree I had for many, many, many years. But I, on the strength of my FCC licenses, after I left Motorola, Motorola was basically having me fly somewhere every Monday and working on a project until Friday and flying home for the weekends and then flying somewhere else. And I was in my 20s and that was, it was fun. But at a certain point, it's like, I'm not all that super happy flying somewhere every week and being away. So I started looking for a job. I was living with some friends in Malibu at the time in a big house, and I paid $100 a month for my rent for my room. And what can I do with my technical knowledge? What can I do with my licenses? So I went into two places. I went into General Telephone. Okay. That certainly is a technology company. And at the same time, I also walked into the offices of Warner Cable, which was the other technology company in Malibu. With General Telephone, I started going through their program, was tested. They loved the test results. They figured out that I could probably do pretty much anything that they had to offer. And at the same time, when I walked into Warner Cable in Malibu, the interesting question was not, did I have any experience, but did I have a license? What kind of license do you want? Well, we have a microwave system here and we have no one licensed to sign the logbook. You got a license? I said, yeah. As a matter of fact, while I was at Motorola, I got a second class phone and then a first class phone with radar endorsement. They said, you've got a first class phone with radar endorsement. I said, yeah, I do. And they said, you're hired. So in the cable business, if you know this term, you'll know it. I got hired not knowing a bug nut from a bug up my ass in cable TV to run a cable system, which wasn't that hard because, frankly, it's RF transmission into a piece of coax that doesn't connect to an antenna. It connects to a resistor. So I knew how to do that.
For the audience, including me, who doesn't know what a bug nut is.
A bug nut is the clamp that holds the lashing wire onto the strand, which holds the cable. And I'm deep diving into this,
it's going to be a
basically
quiz,
it's a piece of hardware that holds the cable up in the air. And I do know what a bug up my ass is, just so we're clear on that.
Okay. We don't do that on this show.
Okay, good. All right.
Yeah, we actually do that a lot.
But so we do. Okay. Yeah, I'm kidding.
So how does this relate back to me becoming a lawyer?
Yeah.
And the answer is very interesting. So I got my Associate of Science in 77-ish, and I transitioned and I worked in the cable industry for a number of years. roughly till 1984. And by that time, I was a regional engineer. I'd worked my way up to be regional engineer. In the land of the blind, the one-eyed technician is king. I was unceremoniously laid off from my company when all of us in middle management were fired because my company at the time was being sold to a larger cable company. And I went for a couple of weeks not knowing what I was going to do. And because I had worked with so many cities at the time, representing my cable operator that I was working for, one of them called and said, "Hey, I heard you got laid off. Congratulations, you're not the only one. We're looking for a consultant to give us some advice." I said, "Sounds like an idea." That's now over 2,000 cities ago that I've worked for, directly or indirectly. I'm still getting to the point of how it gets.
We have plenty of time.
So this is 1984. From 1984, about 1989, I was asked to co-chair an FCC sanctioned committee to develop new standards for cable TV. And I had been asked by some national groups that knew of me, and I had worked for a lot of governments by that point, and I helped to develop those standards, the cable TV standard. In fact, those standards are still in force now, although of limited value because they're the analog standard for cable TV. But so many of those came off of my word processor at the time. An Apple II Plus, I think. And that led to an interesting phone call. My wife and I were in New York, just on a vacation, and I got a call from the Department of Justice. This was 1987. 1987, the DOJ calls me and they say, the 1996 Telecom Act has been in place and Playboy is suing the United States over a provision related to cable TV scrambling. Can you be our expert? Sure. Went down to DC from New York while we were there. They hired me. I ended up representing the US. Interesting side note, to demonstrate that what Playboy said wasn't true, that in fact, it was impossible for cable systems to effectively scramble their programming, I actually produced a video using equipment from the city of Thousand Oaks to actually produce porn as a trial exhibit in that case that was held in Delaware, Wilmington, Delaware. That was it. And because of that case, finally, we're at the point of why do I become a lawyer? Well, I won that part of the case for the government. The technology issue fell aside. It became a First Amendment case. And in most First Amendment cases, the government has the greatest burden and did not prevail. But my portion, which was to prove that it wasn't technically impossible to do what the law required, I won on. Come back from that case, testifying in Wilmington, Delaware, my wife says to me, this is almost exactly how it happened. You know, you're an idiot. And I looked at her and I said, today? And she said, no. I said, why am I an idiot? She said, look, you just came back from testifying in federal court. You ghosted briefs for the attorneys. You did legal research for them. You taught them the technology. And by that point, I was already teaching CLE courses, continuing legal education courses, for some of the governments I work with. She said, why aren't you a lawyer? And apparently I didn't have a good enough answer that day. So she said, I have enrolled you to go into a introductory session at a local Los Angeles school, not ABA, but one where you can qualify to take the bar. And the hours are flexible and you can do it. And I went to law school, 1997. I loved it. I loved it. The education of law, the understanding how law works and how all those things that drive our daily lives work together. Something I thoroughly enjoyed. For me, it was a 4-year history lesson. and graduated with honors. And as my wife likes to say, I eventually passed the California bar.
Eventually?
It wasn't the first time that I passed it, but, uh-huh. but you know, it's an old story, which is how many clients ask you how many times it took to pass the bar? The only people who ever asked me that, interestingly, has been when I've been deposed by attorneys who are trying to discredit me. And that's a lot of fun. And a lot of people say, well, how did you get into law school? You didn't have a bachelor's degree. And that law school didn't require it because I had, you know, 20 some odd years of work experience and mm-hmm. tremendous expert witness work and all that. So they let me in. Their mistake. So this is how I became a lawyer. And I actually began practicing in 2006. In 2011, I decided, since I had the JD at that point, I would go on for a master's of law degree. And I obtained my master's of law degree in telecommunications from Royal College in Scotland, Strathclyde University. They didn't care that I didn't have a bachelor's degree because I had a JD. In 2013, I passed the New Mexico bar exam. Why New Mexico? Because I spent a lot of time in New Mexico. And the joke is that my wife and I used to take trips to Santa Fe and to Albuquerque, and now we take marketing trips. Don't tell the IRS. Mm-hmm. So, and after that, still hungry for more education, I enrolled in Northeastern University's Doctor of Law and Policy course and went through that and was finally hooded as a Doctor of Law and Policy. So that's why I'm technically a double doc, although technically you also never call yourself a doctor if you're a lawyer. But I call myself a doctor because I have a terminal degree in law now. So a lot of the interesting work I've done in amateur radio and law has been to basically help planners understand amateur radio and help amateurs understand planning, because they're completely different languages. And if you tell an amateur radio operator that they can't have their 60 some odd foot tower, you know, they say, hey, but this is what I need. This is the tower I've got. But then I can start talking to the planners and saying, look, amateur radio is protected by PRB1 and by the California legislature and some government code rules. So finding the accommodations, and that gets back to engineering. Now we've gone all the way back to engineering. And what's the engineering? Show me a neck report. Show me the best takeoff angle for the antenna that you've got, because it's not necessarily going to be at 60 feet. It might be at 40 feet. So if you can find a justification for an appropriate height that is really the best for the particular antenna in accommodations. And that gets back to engineering. How you find answers when you've got an amateur radio operator who says, I have a God-given right to do anything, and a local government planner who says, I have a God-given right to deny anything.
Right.
I really enjoy that portion of my work.
And is it more of it helping? I guess it's helping both. I was going to say, is more of it helping the city, you know, work it out with the amateur work out with the city, but it's probably right on both ends a little bit.
I am an attorney who finds litigation detestable. Mm-hmm. And litigation is, in so many times I've seen this happen, litigation is because one party is either uneducated or obstinate, and the other party is either uneducated or obstinate. Mm-hmm. And my distaste for litigation has led me to find solutions that neither side fully approves of, wishes they could have, but it solves the problem. And I think some of the highest calling a lawyer can do is to solve problems, not just fight. It drives me crazy when I come up against attorneys who live to fight. They don't care what they're fighting about. They only care to win. They don't care about the collateral damage. They don't care about all the harm that might occur. They don't solve problems. And I enjoy solving problems.
And I know you have a firm, and I know you're also getting ready to retire from that firm or in the process of that. What's been the major business? Is the major core of that business is around wireless activities?
Yeah, the two major areas that we work in, three, interestingly, out in the third one, you'll never guess. But the first area is municipal law, whether it's developing wireless ordinances or working with local governments who are dealing with the big tower companies or the wireless carriers. We do a lot of that work. We have a separate division. I have 10 people in the firm. It's not a small firm. 10 people and two CEOs, canine executive officers. You're supposed to laugh at that, David.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah. Okay.
Any other hams?
And the other major portion of the firm does planning. We work as contract planners for local governments. So they get projects in from AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile. Mm-hmm. They ask us to review it for compliance with all of the applicable codes, all the standards and so forth, the exceptions that are built into the FCC rules. And then we write the planning reports, guide the planners as to how to appropriately process that. So those are the two major divisions of the firm.
Mm-hmm.
And we do, gosh, we must do, I don't know, 1,000 wireless projects a year, just mm-hmm. on the planning side, that we're touching 1,000 sites. And then the third area that you would never think of is billboards. We do a lot of billboard work. Why billboards? Well, like wireless, it touches the ground. I'm a dirt lawyer. In the lawyering world, we call ourselves dirt lawyers if you do real estate. And this is all real estate work. Billboards touch the ground. They require a clear, call it a line of sight for its transmission.
Just transmitting. Right. There you
right.
go.
And so blockages become an issue, the same as antennas.
Mm-hmm.
They are typically leased parcels under long-term leases. So there's actually a tremendous synergy between wireless tower siting and leasing and billboard tower siting, billboard leasing. So those are the three major areas of my law firm. Been doing it for now almost 20 years, and I'm getting ready to step back. Whether I actually retire, the biggest problem is I really have fun at what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
The person who is going to take over for me started in my law firm as an intern, Trip May. He's grown to be a son to me, and I'm tremendously proud of him. I take credit for all of his successes. But as a proud father would, I suppose. But we have wonderful people. And the thing about this law firm, which is different from so many, is that people actually like it, like to talk to each other. So many law firms I walk into and the halls are dead silent. People don't talk to each other and they don't want to interact and there's jealousy. Ugh. No thanks.
Yeah, and competition. So amateur radio, you do a little bit of amateur radio stuff. And I know that you do some consulting for the ARL. Is that right?
Well, not directly. The work I'm doing in amateur radio these days is so much of it's related to disaster communications. Amateur radio emergency service is tremendously important to me. I'm as you know, David, I'm a member of LAX Northwest, and I'm EC on the west side of LA. I'm also serving the other local ARES club in the area is Culver City, California, and I'm their local government liaison. And I really, really enjoy emergency communications and digital communications. And for so many years, that has been really what has kept me hungry in amateur radio.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, David, as you know, every first month or every first Saturday of the month, when we have our LAX meetings, we have the after meeting. What's the after meeting? It's when we give ham tests. And The single thing I enjoy the most about amateur radio, without exception, is being a member of a VEC team, bringing new people into our hobby. There is nothing that gives me greater pleasure in amateur radio than my VEC work and watching people pass the test and then walking up to them and saying things from that range from welcome to the hobby to that's the last ham test you'll ever take.
Yeah, I guess it depends on which test that you're giving out that day.
Every so often, this has happened now twice or three times in the years that I've been a VEC, we've had unicorns. Mm-hmm. Or someone has walked in with no license and walked out extra. Now, yeah. This is exceedingly rare, but incredibly, incredibly satisfying. And again, it is singularly the most important thing for me in amateur radio is to help bring in new people into the hobby.
Most of those people that come in, do they come in planning to do that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I can't imagine taking an extra.
And they typically will have doctor in front of his or her name. And the doctorate will be in, let me guess, electrical engineering. Yeah. So they are unicorns, but unicorns exist.
I can't imagine passing an extra just because you passed the tech and they said, let's try for the general. And you squeak by that. But the extra, that's way above.
Well, in our test group, we always tell people, look, you just passed the tech. Do you want to take the general just to take a look at it and see how you do? And I'll tell you why you should. I'll tell you why you should. Remember back I told you that I had a first class, which is now a general radio telephone license, and I have a radar endorsement. When I took my first class test back in the 70s, when I was working for Motorola, and those were back in the days when the FCC used to do field tests in rotation in an area, and the FCC was at the Bakersfield Library, the Bakersfield Public Library, giving ham and commercial tests. Well, I took my first class there, and the woman said, would you like to try the radar endorsement? And I had studied Schrader, and I'd looked through the book a little bit. I said, well, can I come back tomorrow? Because this was a Saturday and they were doing something. No, you've got to take it now. So I said, okay. So I took the test booklet, I took the answer sheet and I sat down and I went through those 50 questions on the radar endorsement in 15 minutes. I did look close. I marked it and I went through it. It was for fun. So I didn't have to worry about it. And I walked back up and, yes, can I help? No, I'm done. What? All right. And she gets out the template and she puts it in. You passed. I passed. Shh, shh, shh. That is literally God's honest truth how I ended up with a radar endorsement. So when we tell people, do you want to take a look at the general? People, when you study for technician, a lot of people will glance ahead and, you know, you can be pleasantly surprised. And I've certainly seen that in my own life. So never fear striding beyond your grasp, because sometimes you might actually grab onto something.
Yeah. It doesn't cost extra. It's worth a try.
That's right. And in our group, we don't charge per test. We charge per test session. I don't know. I hope that doesn't violate any rules with the ARL.
Yeah, I don't think it does.
Okay.
Which VE are you working with?
I have two certifications, one through ARRL, of course, and the other through the Greater Los Angeles group, which I don't use very often, but it's nice to have both of the certifications so that I can give the test at whatever group is available or needs a third living body at the time.
Yeah, that first Saturday is always the ARRL session.
Yeah.
But GLARG, the Greater Los Angeles, that they've grown a lot over the years, and it's almost all down. They were some of the pioneers in the early part of the pandemic of getting everything online and doing almost exclusively online. Even if you're sitting in the room with the VEs now, you're doing a computer, mostly computer-based test. Yeah, on an iPad or a phone or something like that. I know if you ask her big, they'll give you a paper and you can mark up the paper, but you have to tell them ahead of time that that's what you want. But I know the ARL, they're still using the old paper and the vinyl overlays, you know, for grading.
Yeah, that's what we're doing. And the ARL does have the online testing as well available to it. But I'm going to be 70 in just a few months. So I'm old school. I kind of like the paper and the overlays as well. It's how I grew up.
Yeah. It's kind of quick and easy. Although I guess if you're doing it digitally, you push the button and you know your score.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we grade the test immediately too. And following the normal protocol, we have three VEs grade every test because sometimes someone will miss something or sometimes someone will mark something wrong that was correct. So we want to ensure accuracy. And that's why we always have three people grade every single test.
Yeah. I know for sure that's part of the protocol. I went through the ARL VEC and, you know, I think mine's lapsed because we weren't doing enough and I did a little bit with Clark. I don't do that so much. I'm one of those guys at the end of that meeting after being there for 2.5 hours, it's time to go when you guys get all set up and ready and get those test sessions going.
Well, David, to be sure, you have some other very important responsibilities in the group that you're definitely not a slacker. You're in charge of our weekly nets. You basically co-run the group with Ruzi. So I don't think you're slacking off by not being a VE at the point.
Yeah. Someday I'm going to stay and take a test, but I look at the book and I study a little bit and I just don't have enough time to make it to that one last level where you can shake my hand and say, no more tests for you.
So Jonathan, how would you recommend that David go about studying and getting his extra?
You know, everybody studies differently. I am the type of person, I hold 7 FCC licenses at this point, 7 separate licenses, of which I think 5 require tests. The way that I do it, frankly, is I download the question pool. I throw it into a word processor. I erase all of the wrong answers. I don't study distractors. I study the question and the right answer. And then because the questions repeat, you see the multiple incarnations of the question, but you also get an idea about what is being tested. So my way of studying for tests has always been to focus on the right answers. Don't get distracted by the wrong answers. Look up the answers that don't make any sense to me. Mm-hmm. And I've never failed an amateur radio or commercial test using that method. For me, it works. For other people,
and after you've done that study, do you go take practice? Because I know they say, oh, do that, study whatever, and then take a bunch of practice tests until you have a certain proficiency.
Yeah. And certainly as a lawyer, you don't take a bar exam without practicing.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you what happens if you don't.
Okay. I got to know. How many times did you take the bar?
Shh. I would say that in New Mexico, it was one time. That much I'm willing to say.
Okay. You can truthfully say you passed the bar on your first try.
You know, it's interesting. I've never obtained, there's only one license in my entire life that I've obtained that I actually needed at that moment. Any idea what that license is?
Right, your driver's license.
Exactly right, David. That's the only license in my entire life that I've ever gotten that I needed at that moment.
Yeah.
And I've never not used a license I've gotten.
How many radar systems have you tinkered with?
Okay, so when I say that I've used licenses, I may not have done something specific with it, but my CV is 54 pages long because I have tracked everything religiously over the years. And I will tell you without a doubt that every piece of paper you have differentiates you from other candidates. And you never know what someone's looking for when they're looking to hire you, when they're looking to retain your services. But if you don't have it, you can never capitalize on it. So I always tell people, go for every certification, go for every license. You may not actually use that license in a day-to-day practice, but it differentiates you and it tells people that you're willing to put in the effort to do the work to get that additional step up. And there are a lot of people, especially older professionals who have been there and understand that and say, this person looks great on paper and I don't know this person. This person interviews well, but doesn't have a lot of the background qualifications. The qualifications, the experience, the number of, I track the number of times I've been quoted in the press. This video will go on to my CV.
Woohoo! I'll apologize in advance for that.
You can do that. Yeah. But
some of them advance you a little bit. Some of them knock you back some.
Yeah.
Yeah. This one, I'm not seeing me knocking back from it, but the bottom line is that anyone in any profession who doesn't track their achievements and doesn't reach for the achievements that most people will not try to do is missing out. It's a pure differentiator. And it's a tremendous differentiator. Education, besides being wonderful, sets you apart from other people who don't have the interest in being educated. I'm looking for people who have a hunger for education. Certainly all the people who work for me qualify in that respect.
Yeah, that's an important differentiator for sure. When you talked about, and we're going to circle around here somewhere, when you talked about the ARI stuff you did, digital communications. What kind of digital communications are you doing? Are you interested in?
Well, back in the 80s, the first tapper board I built, the serial number was in the 300s. Mm-hmm. So that'll kind of date me.
Which toy?
Which
tapper kit?
The original, I think it was the second version board. I can't remember. I remember is I remember sitting in San Juan Capistrano at the home I was living in and burning the table I was working on because I set down the soldering iron and forgot it was there. You know, that's the true mark of a kit builder is when you burn a table.
Yep.
At 300 baud tapper.
And would have been a packet modem.
Packet and yeah. And that's when it was cool to beacon because there were so few people out there that you wanted to hear the beacons. But I've always enjoyed digital communications, and in fact, I'm DMR and all that stuff is fine. I'm just starting to play with LoRa and Meshtastic, and in fact, yesterday we were up at our field day site coming up. Field day in a couple of weeks. We're in Culver City at our field day site and just doing some preliminary work in advance of that. And then we're going to be setting up on LoRa as well. I like digital. I like ones and zeros.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll ask on behalf of the audience. LoRa? What is LoRa?
LoRa, long range. It's basically 900 megahertz unlicensed band mesh radios using the Meshtastic protocol.
Low powered
and interoperable. It's
what kind of what kind of bandwidth and what kind of data rate?
It's basically, if you think of it as texting, that's about it. It's definitely not like Arden. I'm very involved in Arden. I love Arden.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I'm working right now to set up Blinks here in Southern California to, I live in an Arden radio hole in Santa Monica, which is crazy that there's not, I'm the only station, I think, well, there's one other station in Santa Monica. We can't even hear each other on Arden. So we're tunneling out. But LoRa is low power, narrow bandwidth, but amazingly resilient. You can hear LoRa can get through when you're looking at a spectrum analyzer and all you see is the noise floor. LoRa will still get through.
Is that the system, is that the system where you can set up your station and other people can connect and get some messages through?
Yes.
Through you? Yes. Yeah, I've heard about it. I didn't remember the name, but I've heard about it.
It's an extremely low price point to get in. $35 gets you basically what you need to get on LoRa.
And if you get enough people connecting through you, you can make some money, I guess.
Well, it's not a matter of making money, at least for my end of the world. I mean, I'm interested in having when SHTF,
which here in Southern California
means earthquake.
We can say the bad words here. We don't specialize in them, but we can
Say
that.
Sorry. I always try to keep the kids here, but it's okay.
Look, when I'm born and raised in Southern California, so I have ridden out major earthquakes here. And I know that whatever people think about the resilience of the commercial networks, they suck. We will be, amateur radio operators will be the communications conduit and have been so many times over major earthquakes, power outages. We drill for this purpose. We drill to be ready. We drill to handle traffic. We drill to be able to go out and set up off-grid amateur radio stations. We serve here in Southern California what's called ReadyNet, which is when an ambulance is dispatched and they pick up somebody, they check in with ReadyNet to find out what hospital to take them to. That's all based on internet connectivity. And when that happens and the earthquakes hit, it's going to be Arden. It's going to be voice traffic that's actually helping to direct emergency resources to move stocks between hospitals. I personally am assigned to St. John's Hospital in Santa Monica. That's the hospital I go to. And this is at our core what we do for the public. This is what at our core what we do for the public, which is to provide the real backup when everything else fails. That's something I'm incredibly proud of as an amateur radio operator. Something I'm incredibly proud of as an ARIES member. It's something I'm incredibly proud of as a CERT member. You know, they all kind of all go together in my view.
Okay, I'll ask once again for the audience because I know what this is, but a lot of people might not. What is CERT?
Community Emergency Response Team. The history of CERT is that it was here in Los Angeles that I think it was the county. Was it the county, David?
I think it's city fire.
Okay.
I think it's where it's
Thank you. LA City Fire came up with a program basically to train civilians how to be home-based first responders. Because as we know, in any emergency, whether it's a hurricane or an earthquake or a flood, services are not going to be readily available. So having people trained in their homes to be able to do support of their neighbors and themselves, to be able to report back to an EOC using a common language and a common protocol, the things that we learn how to communicate, how to do searches in our neighborhood, how to bring resources in the neighborhood together. That's CERT, Community Emergency Response Team. And so many amateur radio operators I know are also members of CERT. Mm-hmm. They truly go hand in hand because having the information but not being able to communicate it to the emergency authorities doesn't help you a lot. I mean, it helps that small block, but it doesn't help the EOC to paint the picture of what's happening on a community-wide basis. So again, amateur radio and CERT are married together, and every amateur should be a member of CERT. That's my viewpoint.
So it's not just communications.
I'm sorry?
It's not just communications. They have first aid and a bunch of other functions.
CERT trains you on first aid. It trains you on fire suppression. It trains you on how to conduct searches, how to open doors.
CERT is really that, you know, in the stuff hits the fan scenario. The CERT is the idea behind the whole program is in that first 15 minutes, that first hour of an event that happens, it's the ability to get folks out in their neighborhoods to help their neighbors. Because there's not enough professionals to respond in a really large scale disaster to everybody's problem that's going to be going on. And, you know, really the idea behind it, I think, is mostly like keeping blocks from burning down and keep people from dying of untreated, you know, illnesses. You know, that's, and the first thing when I did, and I'm not a member of CERT, but I'm CERT trained. I've gone through the program a couple times because in our community here where I live in Woodland Hills, it's not an active group. There's a bigger, you know, LA City Fire is a bigger active group, but there's not a very active part out in my part of the valley. And, but the, you know, the first part they teach you is, okay, well, what are you looking for? What do you do? How do you respond? You know, what's a gas meter look like? How do you turn it off? Water meter? What does it look like? What do you turn it off? And what does it look like when there's something wrong with it? Because they tell you don't turn off a gas meter that doesn't have a problem. But if you see the dial spinning and that there's gas coming out, you turn those things off. And then you help the people to see if they need assistance. Some CERT members have radio. Oh, sorry, Jonathan, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that CERT is essentially like a propagating wave from an omnidirectional antenna. Mm-hmm. And first you start locally. And as the wave goes out, it has less impact, but it overlaps other waves. So really you secure your home first, your family, then you go for your neighbors, then you go for the block, and then you start communicating outside of that. So it is how to have a positive, immediate impact where it's needed the most, which is the place where the public safety people can't get to quickly.
Right.
So the description that I've had in terms of the ham can participate is that for communications, you'll have a lot of people who aren't hams, but they would use FRS radios over the range they can get. And then the ham is the conduit out of that little local radio network.
That's how I became a ham, because we brought CERT into our elementary school to help us with emergency preparedness when my kids were of that age. And on the last day of the class I took, actually, in fact, it was the second class I took because I missed a day. And they said, oh, well, you got to go take that day at another class because, you know, you have to make the whole 4 days. And so I got to find the other one. And I'm like, well, if I'm going to do it, I might as well show up for all 4 days. And on the last of the 4 days, which was one I had took before, the last day, a couple of guys showed up that were amateur radio operators and said, hey, in addition to this, you can do this thing. And it might help you serve the community. And, you know, you get to play with these toys and this and that and radio and all those things. And that's what sparked my interest such that 2 months later, I was sitting taking my tech.
It's a wonderful story. It's beautiful.
That's how I got here.
CERT is not actually operational everywhere. There may be a local CERT that I'm not aware of here in the Fort Mill, South Carolina area. I suppose I should look. I don't know how I could fit it into my schedule, even as a retired person. How much time does it take for you guys?
Well, Jonathan's more active, so I would, yeah.
Yeah, CERT, the CERT program that I took, actually I took one and three quarters. The one part of it is I'm certified in the city of Santa Monica. That was a 3-weekend process. I started to certify with the city of Culver City as well. And I never got to the third class because this thing called COVID hit and the fire department said, yeah, we really don't want people coming into our firehouse, exposing our firefighters to COVID. Mm-hmm. But CERT is a commitment of probably 25 hours over a period of time.
Yeah.
But it's,
I think it's changing a little bit too. I think that's the initial, you know, to be CERT trained, right? That's that initial 20 hours. And there, I guess in LA, there are some levels, you know, if you have first aid training, you have another level, and then there's some other level. Yeah. And then at some areas, and you know, you have to look and see in your community, Gary, in some areas they have, like in the city of LA, they have what they call call out teams, you know, where it's more rigorous. They do a lot of training. They get together on a very regular basis to show you gears, to have you do stuff, to support, you know, firefighters in the city of Los Angeles when they need extra help. But just at the basics, getting cert to train that 20, 25 hours, you know, everybody should do that. Honestly, it should be like, I'd love it to be part of that high school curriculum to graduate as a senior. Yes. You need to have gone through this 25 hours of, just like they should teach you to, you know, balance a checkbook, whatever that is, to my millennial kids, or any of these other life skills that they don't teach. But those should be one of those things that they should teach them how to do.
I can say that both in Santa Monica and Culver City here in Southern California, there is a direct tie between CERT, EMS, fire department, amateur radio. In fact, in Santa Monica, the CERT team, we actually have a specific group of amateur radio operators within CERT. Mm-hmm. So Santa Monica and Culver City have both embraced the combination of amateur radio and CERT membership. And both are very important for community protection and safety.
How often do they call out a CERT group for what kind of things?
Santa Monica calls out probably two or three times a year for various events, training purposes, and we have annual trainings just to keep fresh on it. There are opportunities in CERT to participate in drills, hospital preparedness events, things like that. American Red Cross does programs where they have their people train and then use CERT volunteers as the walking wounded. Mm-hmm. So it helps. The nice thing about that is it cross-pollinates between groups, because yeah. During an emergency,
overlap with ARIES and OXCOM type
activity? Exactly. Red Cross is going to be out there. The other service organizations are going to be out there. So to the extent that we have some familiarity with each other, we don't have to be so closely aligned that we know every procedure. But if we have a working understanding of the other groups and they understand us and what our resources are and what theirs are, we just help the people that we're trying to help, the entire right. community.
I see in the city of Los Angeles, they do, and it's, you know, it's kind of like, it's a combination of there to serve and be advertising, you know, for like the Hollywood Christmas parade. They'll ask for CERT volunteers to come out to help with not crowd control per se, but, you know, directions, right? You're going this way, you're going that way. Help us get here. Help us get there. Information booths and things like that, so that they have people standing around in their green vests and their green hard hats, so that people recognize and understand these are people that are there to help you, which is what the goal of the program is.
There are so many opportunities for us as amateur radio operators to serve the public. I mean, every year I also serve both the LA Marathon and the Rose Bowl Half Marathon. Mm-hmm. And every year something happens and I've called ambulances to come and help people who have needed help. And again, because I'm an amateur radio operator and because we have those nets set up, we're doing that and we're practicing our skills for the big ones. That's it. We're practicing our skills for the big ones.
Yep. Yep. And hopefully it won't be too big. I've sat in some of those CERT trainings where they're like, okay, we're going to help you. Have you CERT members help evacuate the city of Los Angeles? I heard Stacey Gerlich, who used to be in charge of that whole program when I was new a dozen years ago or so. And I heard that at an event and I scratched my head and I wanted to raise my hand and ask for clarification, but I thought better of that. I didn't want to rain on anybody's parade. I was more involved in the amateur radio side than the CERT side, but you know, you wonder and I hope that they're there to help. And, you know, I think that that's the value of that program, that CERT program is, you know, in the event of this big kind of disaster. And, you know, Gary, maybe where you are, if it's a tornado or hurricane or whatever, to be able to get out in your neighborhood and check your neighbors. I mean, that's really the key, you know, is your family safe? Are your neighbors safe? Is your neighborhood okay? And if we had more of that, you know, spread out through all of our communities, things would go better in the big disasters.
Yeah.
There'd be somebody to be there.
Okay. I didn't mean to direct it.
It's a privilege to be an amateur radio. It's a privilege to be an amateur radio. And I never forget that privilege at any time. And that's why it's a privilege to bring people into the hobby. It's a privilege to see people grow through the hobby. It's a privilege to hear those reports on the radio and the TV stations after an emergency where they say, via amateur radio, we've heard the following, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, this is very gratifying because it means we're doing our job and we're doing our job well.
Yeah, I think so. Totally think so.
I would like to steer things back to the law and antennas a little bit. Mm-hmm. Jonathan, I imagine you have been following the legislation, the Amateur Radio Emergency Preparedness Act, that has been in Congress now for about 2.5 years. And we all had high hopes at the beginning of when it was introduced last year. But Congress is just about done. Everybody's going to go home and campaign. All the Congress people and a third of the senators. So, do we have a chance for that legislation this year? It's been introduced, but it's been sitting still.
I've worked for local governments now for better part of 40 years. There is a term that if you're in this business, you learn very quickly. It's called silly season. And we're in silly season. The run-up to elections are silly season. And during silly season, things that should happen don't. Things that shouldn't happen do. I truly believe that the things that we have to overcome as amateur radios, CCNR problems, homeowner association issues that are related to it, will be solved on a state-by-state basis, and eventually there'll be enough history that the world doesn't come to an end because of it, that we can see some national legislation. But it's I don't see it this year at the national level. I do see state initiatives. We should be fighting to overcome some of the absolutely arcane CCNR restrictions that make no sense, especially in light of OTARD. The FCC has been willing to step in and preempt CCNRs as to over-the-air receiving devices, satellite dishes, broadcast antennas, and so forth. That would be a route that would take a national perspective. I don't know that this FCC has the interest in doing that. I don't see Congress doing it. I see it more at the FCC and at the state level. I wish I had a better perspective than that, but I think that's my perspective.
Now we saw a little bit of FCC activity earlier in the year. It's like, oh, wait, the FCC is paying attention to amateur radio again. And then it's been all quiet on that front.
Well, there were some changes.
A couple things happened.
The data rate stuff. Yeah. And that's positive for me for some of the digital stuff that I do.
That's happened. I'm looking at the bill. In the House, there's 10 co-sponsors. When we were doing this back in 2016, I think they were well over 100 co-sponsors. So
yeah.
It's like, man, I haven't really pushed very hard on this year.
I don't have high hopes this year. You know, it's interesting. It's so much gets done the first year after a presidential election during the so-called honeymoon period. I don't know if that's going to happen this year, given the political divides that exist. I think the three of us, well, at least the two older people here and then the young kid, the two older people here grew up in a time when Congress was much more willing to work across the aisle for its common goals. Not so much anymore, unfortunately.
Yeah, and this is not really
you're for it, I've got to be against it type of mentality.
This is not a partisan thing. I don't, you know, looking at the co-sponsors, there's
everything is partisan.
That's the I think
everything is partisan.
Yeah, here are the co-sponsors. There's 6 Republicans, 4 Democrats. So this is in that area of bipartisan. But
yeah,
but with Congress not doing very much, the House not doing very much, I think the bill total is still below 30 for bills that have been passed this year.
Yeah, it's insane.
Yeah, they're just fighting for the sake of fighting and not doing anything very deliberately, which means that the little things that could easily pass still aren't happening because somebody's got their foot put down and they're not going to
pass. Perhaps we're in silly season all the time.
Yeah. So we're caught up in that. You were mentioning state by state, and there was some hope here in South Carolina, where I live, that a bill had been introduced that would do a more of a PRB1-ish version than a national than an Amateur Radio Emergency Preparedness Act version. It was a relatively simple bill, and it was introduced earlier this year. And the hams went down there and got their moment in the sun at the legislature, but then that bill was terminated for some minor technicality. They'll introduce it again next year and fix the technicality, but that just means it's not going to happen this year here in the state either. I wasn't holding out a lot of hope that it would, but it would be kind of nice because I live here and it would let me put some antennas up on the roof.
And you're in an HOA, right?
Very much an HOA.
And that's what was addressed there.
Yeah. Yeah. It was an HOA thing. It was moving PRB1 into the HOA territory, which was, again, PRB1 is pretty simple stuff compared to all the ingredients that have gone into the into the Emergency Preparedness Act.
I wonder from your perspective, Jonathan, is that the key to making this happen at a national level, is getting a state or two to say, hey, we're going to adopt this at a state level? Or does it work the other way around? Or I guess it doesn't work the other way around because we adopt it nationally. Does it help to get South Carolina on board with this, and now we have a model for, well, this state's doing this?
I'm a big believer that if enough states do something, that even if we don't get the traction at the federal level, other states will feel safe enough to adopt it. Mm-hmm. And the bigger the states, the easier it is to do it. The problem, again, is a political divide. If you can get Texas and California to do something, right, the odds are it's going to be able to spread, because you can point, regardless of the favorite color you have, you can say, here's something that people that like my color agree on. And even the other side has the same thing.
Mm-hmm. And if you can get Texas and California, then you've got the left and the right.
I was trying to be a little bit more gentle than that, but yeah,
making it look like it's not a partisan fight.
Yeah.
What was the famous line from a Leon Redbone song? The left ones think I'm right. The right ones think I'm wrong.
The left ones think I'm right. The right ones think I'm wrong.
Magic song is the name of the song. It's always struck me as being an incredibly telling lyric. And this is what we have to overcome, because what's happening is that the things that we can do that are positive for the communities, that are positive for promoting cooperation and safety, are falling behind. This is a numbers game, and those numbers start at home. I have seen time and time again, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times, where I've sat at city council meetings where 5 people come in and they sway an issue at the local level. And then you get up to the county level and the same thing happens. At the state level, it's a lot more difficult, because then you've got a lot more, you've got far more commercial, professional, political operatives who are representing special interests. Look, the HOA special interests are tremendously powerful. Don't ever forget that. So the arguments that we have to have are, calling on our track record of saving lives, of promoting public safety, and at the cost of what? A section of CCNR that is partially preempted anyway because of the FCC OTARD rules. So if we can't do it at the OTARD level, let's get OTARD-type protections at the state level. And you start out, as you always do, with narrow carve-outs, and you expand the carve-outs. But if we can do that, we can start to overcome the problem that we have, which is a legal problem. And frankly, I think a lot of problems are fostered by ignorance at the HOA board level and by attorneys who serve HOAs who just say, well, I don't want to rock the boat with my HOA client. Unfortunately, we get lumped together with commercial radio services like Verizon and AT&T and people's fear of RF. This has become wild. I actually co-authored the FCC's National Guide to Local Governments on RF Safety. So seeing how the public reacts to the microwatts of power put out by the utility meter transceivers, it's nonsensical. I don't get it.
We're having trouble with science all around out there in the public these days.
Yes. Science is pesky.
Yes, not to politicize it too much.
So Expert Ham Radio in the chat wants to know why hams move into HOA neighborhoods and then complain about the rules. And this is a fairly common complaint or fairly common comment about it. And there are some things you can say about that. Not everybody was a ham when they moved into their house.
I moved into a home 20 years ago in Santa Monica as part of an HOA. Now, there are only three people in the HOA because it's a building. So I knew that wasn't going to be a problem, and had some discussions with the other owners at the time. We're still the owners today. The building's been very stable. But that's the outlier.
Yeah, and I wonder, in like some places where there's like a lot of new, I mean, maybe where you are, Gary, where there's a lot of new construction. Yeah,
try to find a house
that's
HOA.
That's part of the point, you know. In Los Angeles, it's maybe not as hard because there's not as many housing developments. But as you get out into the urban sprawl, into, you know, Santa Clarita and Riverside, and, you know, going further down south, it's all any subdivision now comes with an HOA for whatever reason, bad or otherwise.
If you want new or even within the past 15, 20 years construction, if you're willing to buy in a old legacy neighborhood like David lives in,
like where I live in,
then you can find houses that are not restricted. The last neighborhood we were in, the two neighborhoods ago, which meant Cindy bought the house in the mid 90s, big deal HOA. In that case, I was able to talk them into letting me put up a pretty good size, you know, the 19-foot vertical on the roof and a dipole. Next neighborhood, 17, 18 years ago now, a dipole was okay because it's hard to see, but no big white-masted dual-band vertical. And then this neighborhood, I haven't even approached them to ask because they're boilerplate language and they don't understand the concept, but you know, someday I might go ask them. I was kind of hoping for that legislation to go through in South Carolina.
Look, I think this is something where we just have to continue to press forward and know that it's a long-term process. One of the things that you learn when you're studying policy, as I did at Northeastern, is that policy operates in a circle. You start out by identifying problems and you identify potential solutions. And then you go out as a policy entrepreneur. And this is really a step that most people don't know. You have to be a policy entrepreneur to find other people who have similar interests, not necessarily identical, but where you can find people who have enough similar interests that they can support you. And then you get legislation passed, and then you get back at the top of the circle again, and then you start refining it and expanding it or contracting it or tweaking it, whatever you want to call it. But one of the things I learned as a policy entrepreneur decades ago is that there are no permanent enemies, only permanent interests. that's not my sting. I learned that. But it's something I was taught early on in my political career. There are no permanent enemies, only permanent interests. And if you can figure out that, you can find the people who will help you. And they'll often come from surprising places. Like, I mean, the Red Cross, the other service organizations are our natural policy partners. They are our natural policy partners because we help them do. And if you think that the Red Cross or the other service organizations have little political clout, you are dead wrong.
Yeah. All right. One of my favorite answers about the question about complaining about the rules is that part of the rules is that if you don't like the rules, you can work to change the rules.
You can try.
And those are within the rules. That's something you can do. You're not guaranteed to win, but you can try.
Yeah. Winning is a really ambiguous term. You make progress.
Yeah.
You make progress. There is, ultimately, as someone who has worked in the policy arena for decades now and now has a formal education in, there is no winning. There is simply moving closer to a goal, but it's always an intermediate goal because there's always the next thing. And you have to keep on looking at what does this mean when we achieve this particular, when we move the ball down the field, to use a sports analogy, which we're taught we're not supposed to do. But
right, you have to pick the next goal or the next target or the next. Yeah.
Well, I would say if we were to somehow get the Emergency Preparedness Act through, whether you call it a win or just a progress, it's a big step of progress. In and of itself, it will solve a lot of problems for us.
Some would suggest that the FCC is a collection of certain fees for amateur radio, which are based on, as best I can tell, it's because we say that's how much it should be, as opposed to how much it actually costs them to do it. I mean, last time I checked, amateurs are doing the bulk of the work here. I mean, we're doing the testing, we're doing the grading, we're doing the uploading.
They don't even mail licenses anymore.
They don't mail licenses anymore. That's right.
Yeah. But how much does $3.50 a year buy you?
Yeah, well, that's a question.
This is fascinating because you've looked at it over a 10-year period, and I look at it as, what does a kid say that says I have to pay $35, and what else could I do with $35 that has a more immediate return to me? So this gets part of the education process. I think that there are enough of us in amateur radio who have had successes in our careers, who know of enough 501c3s in amateur radio. Many clubs now are setting up 501c3s to take donations. Mm-hmm. I'm a strong proponent. In fact, right now at this very moment, I'm helping Seek Cares in Culver City set up their own 501c3. But it's a way of giving people who need a benefit tax-wise to help people who need a benefit financially. So if we as amateur radio operators can act as that conduit, great, more power to us. So if you want to fight the FCC's fee, that's fine. That's a tough fight. If you want to collect money to offset it because there are people who understand the value, that's a much easier sell.
Yeah. We've done that with some of our groups where we'll pay for, especially youth, we'll pay for their tests.
Yeah.
So when I think that's a valuable way to do it. And if somebody needs it or says that they can't afford it and they want to take a test, we'll pay for that.
We'll never turn someone away for that reason, ever.
Yeah. Jonathan, in your VE classes or your VE sessions, what is the age range? Are you seeing very many kids?
The youngest was... nine-ish. The oldest who got licensed for the first time is actually someone I've had the privilege of serving as an Elmer for, and he was in his 80s when he passed his tech license.
What's the median?
I see the group problem.
Yeah.
Where's the big bulk in the curve? Is it?
Unfortunately, I wish it trended lower. But I think we see a lot of people in their 50s and 60s who are getting into it as a retirement hobby.
Even 50s and 60s lowers the overall age, I'm afraid.
And you see some younger people some of the times at the test sessions, but it varies. And, you know, that the point is that mostly it is, yes, I'm a young person in this hobby at 57.
Yeah, I was a young person in the hobby when I first started, like you did, Jonathan, at about age 15 or so, yeah. And stayed the young person up until I got into my mid-60s. I'm now finally reaching the median age in my mid-70s.
Yeah. Hey, you know, my kids, all three of my kids in their teen years all got licensed, and they all, you know, they have done service, and they, you know, they don't use it a lot, but they still are active occasionally. You know, son doesn't have a lot of chance, opportunity in the Navy to use it, but that skill set is something that goes along with it. I will apologize, guys, but I have a commitment, and I think we've used a lot of your time very usefully, Jonathan. We appreciate you being here.
You know, you've tapped into one of the most important things in my life, which is to talk about one of the most important things in my life. So thank you for the privilege of being able to do that. And this is fun.
Yeah.
Thank you for letting me have this fun.
Okay. You are Jonathan Kramer at W6JLK. Where do people find you on the air? Local repeaters? 20 meters.
Darn system in Southern California and wherever else Darn is. That's mostly where I can be found.
And do you do any, I've seen that you've been on every other show in ham radio, but do you do any of
no,
your
I
own?
No, I have not.
Not everyone, but some of them.
Do you do your own general media, or you just like being a guest for folks?
At W6JLK,
no blogs or anything?
Well, at W6GLK.com, I have a copy of a presentation I give on how hams can interact with local government planners. I'm from the planning department and I'm here. But it's a presentation I've given many times over the years to especially ARL groups. Take a look there. Send me a message. Love to do it, but thank you guys for the opportunity to take time on your air today.
Glad to have you.
It was great to have you.
Other guy here is
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And I am Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, the high riz, King of Ham. And back to the picture that has everybody in it, because it is now time to say those three little words. Jonathan,
you
get the last word. And you have to figure out what that word is. I will start. Dave will go in the middle. No.
I'm sorry.
That's a good word, but it's not the last word. It's not the word that we have in mind. Here, you'll figure it out. I'm sure you will.
It's the klutzy way we close out the show.
Every show. Over.
And.
Out.
Thanks, Jonathan. Right on the ball. Perfect. Thanks for coming today.
No one has never been able to figure that out.
Oh, I think we've had one or two. We'll send you a link. You can add us to your CV.
I'll go up on my website. But thanks, guys. This was grand fun.
I forgot to have you stand up and show that you're wearing short pants at that time.
Oh, and